light clay straw tumbler is a tool for coating straw with clay slip to create light clay straw, which is then typically used for infilling wood-framed walls. While making light clay straw by hand is easy, if you want to make it in bulk for, say, a house, I recommend building a tumbler. Several years ago, we built a tumbler to infill the walls of our cabin. We used around 80 bales of straw. After the walls were packed, the tumbler moved around the yard for a while and then was slowly cannibalized for parts. We built another tumbler, mostly from scratch, a couple of weeks ago to infill the walls of our Earth Shelter tiny house project, and I record the process. Our tumbler is based on the Riverstone Studios design. I'll link to their video in the notes. The frame is a 2 foot by 6 foot rectangle. I use 2x4s for everything except the legs, which are 4x4s. The tumbler needs to withstand a lot of vibration, so I put in a lot of diagonal braces. I made half lap joints in the legs and fastened them to the frame with lag screws. The barrel cradle is another 2 foot by 6 foot rectangle. I hinge it on one end of the frame to make it easier to adjust the angle of the barrel. The barrel's three 55-gallon metal drums fastened together to form an 8 to 9 foot long barrel. First, I used my angle grinder to cut off the bottoms of the drums. I went through several cheap cutoff wheels, but it went pretty well. Once the ends were cut off, I cut tabs in each of the two drums. This way, one drum can slide or rather be forced inside the other. The tabs were 2 inches deep and initially were 8 inches apart. I had trouble with the second drum, so the tabs are 4 inches apart on that one. Keep in mind that you want the finished non-cut ends of the drums on both of your openings. I'll fasten the drums together with self-tapping screws. Before that, I need to make the fingers. To make the fingers that manipulate the straw as it makes its way down the barrel, I welded a few long nails to 1 foot long pieces of flat steel. This was the only welding I did in this project. The fingers could be replicated using long bolts and sections of slotted steel if you don't want to weld. I had 2 3-foot long pieces of flat steel, so I welded on the nails and cut them into 1 foot sections later. After using the tumbler for a while, I'm really liking the flat steel. We used angle iron in our previous build that tended to trap clay slip. Keeping with the fingers metaphor, we'll call the 1 foot sections of flat steel and nails hands. The hands are attached to the barrel with self-tapping screws. Here are a couple placement considerations. So as a safe precaution, locate the hands no closer than 12 inches from either opening. I put mine 18 inches away from each opening. Put each hand about 120 degrees out of alignment with its neighboring hands. That seems to work well to separate the straw as it makes its way down the barrel. Install the hands as you connect the drums. This way you don't have to crawl too far into the barrel to make your attachments. Make your attachments mid-span between the ribs of the drums so they don't interfere with your casters and drive belt, which will be located close to the ribs. Work with the buddy. Attaching the hands took me about 4 times as long as it should have, because I was doing it by myself. I use 5-inch rigid casters. Since the caster location is dependent on the ridge configuration of the barrel, I mounted each set on a piece of 2x4 that was not tied into the cradle structure. I put the casters about 2 inches from each end so I could easily attach the 2x4 to the cradle. Each set of casters should be located just below a rib of the barrel. In our case, that put the two sets of casters 5.5 feet apart. The barrel is about 2.5 feet longer than the cradle. I found it useful to have more of the overhang on the lower side. A 5 to 10 degree barrel angle seems to be the sweet spot for getting the clay slip and the straw to do their dance. I created a spacer using it, an 8 inch piece of 2x4 with a slide angle on one end attached to a 50 inch 2x4. Here's the spacer in position. The tumbler rotation is driven by a 1/3 horsepower electric motor salvaged from an old dryer. I think any electric motor that size or larger would work. This motor didn't have any good mount points, so I built a small plywood box to fix it in place. The motor spins at around 1700 rotations per minute. We want the tumbler to spin at 20 to 35 rotations per minute. We put a 1.5 inch drive pulley in the motor drive shaft, so if we connected it directly to the 24 inch diameter barrel, the barrel would spin at 1/16 of 1700 rotations per minute, or 106 RPM, which would just push the straw and slip against the sides and not allow it to tumble. To slow it down, we made a secondary drive shaft with two drive pulleys, 1/6 inch and 1/2 inch. The primary drive 1.5 inch shaft connects the 6 inch pulley, so the secondary shaft spins at 1/4 the speed of the motor, or 430 rotations per minute. The 2 inch drive pulley on the secondary shaft is connected to the 24 inch barrel, so it spins at 1/12 the speed of the secondary shaft, or 36 rotations per minute. To make the secondary shaft, I use a pair of pillow blocks and 5 inch solid steel rod. Don't use a threaded steel rod like I did in the earlier video. I use a 3/8 inch wide 30 inch V belt to connect the primary shaft to the secondary shaft, and a 3/8 inch wide 96 inch belt to connect the secondary shaft to the tumbler. I would buy extra 30 inch belts as it takes more of a beating than a longer belt does. To tension the 30 inch belt and align the pulleys, I mounted the motor and secondary shaft assembly on a platform made from two boards connected by 2 1/2 inch threaded rods. The pillow blocks are slightly wider than a 2x4, so my final build I replaced one of the 2x4s with a 1x6, ripped down to 5 inches. I'll demonstrate changing and tensioning the belt in the walkthrough video coming up. Alright, so we processed about 9 bales with the tumbler so far, so I say it's pretty well broken in. So here's our typical setup. Over on the left, we have our slip barrel. And then we have our pitcher up there that we use to get the slip into the barrel. We've got our extra extra belts right here. Keep those handy. So here's the interior. So far, it's held up pretty well. Like, I lost one nail. But apart from that, my welds have all been holding. Over here you can see how these casters are located right by the ribs. The belt I set up to fall right by a rib as well. There's the other caster right there on the rib. And this sort of keeps the barrel from sliding. It sort of keeps the barrel in place. You can see over here, the stand could be a little bit shorter. Because, you know, we usually fill up that wheelbarrow, and right now it's sitting, you know, 2 feet above the wheelbarrow. So I could probably drop the stand, you know, cut those legs off by about a foot and be okay. Let's see if I can squeeze around here. There's my drive system. You see it's flipped upside down from where my drawing is, but it's good to have these tensioners, access the tensioners on top, because now you're probably changing this belt out fairly often. We haven't changed this one out, but you can kind of see how it's starting to wear. So I'll probably change this one out pretty soon. But yeah, it's good to have this stuff accessible. You can see how the it's mounted on these two hinges. And tension on this belt is created by this 25-pound weight that we just have bolted onto our little platform. I've got a little muffin fan on the back here because sometimes the motor will overheat, so it just keeps it cool. And I've got some UF cable that's running to our weatherproof switch box here, which is good because you see it's covered with mud. So there it is. First, we're going to take off the belt
that's going around the
barrel. So let that down. And so this belt we can't get off, so we have to loosen this up some. This side too. I should be able to do that by hand. So I'm going to take off this weight too, just to make it a little easier on us. There we go. So now this will slide back and forth. So it should slide enough so we can get the belt off. Alright, so in this case, I just use these till they break. So I'm just going to put this one back on. So do that. Pull this back. Get our nut sort of finger tight. That's still pretty loose, so now I'll just use my wrench. Check our alignment. So this one probably needs to come back just a touch. And this I just kind of do by eye. I'm trying to just get this pulley and this pulley lined up. And I can do that by moving this back and forth, which shifts this platform right and left. Because if they're not aligned, it just tears this belt up a lot faster. Looks pretty good. Actually, I
and just reattach our big pulley. I mean, our big belt just goes in there like that.
Back in our weight,
which puts tension on this pulley.